Hi guys, this is Dr. Sadashivam once again with you, giving you a complete picture on what is happening on the economic front. We are all aware that we are confronted with the second wave of coronavirus and what steps the government has done in terms of lives and livelihoods. So these are some of the excerpts of the press conference of the RBI Governor Shaktikanta Das. In fact, he had lots and lots of meetings with the corporates and the industry honchos, banking institutions, etc., in terms of what steps the government should take in order to fight this crisis. In fact, most of the people have said that the people in the bottommost pyramid, they were much more affected by the second wave. This is one thing that has very clearly come out from those meetings. So in fact, there have been requests in terms of introducing moratoriums for some more time, certain kinds of refinancing facilities to be given to these people who are suffering, and there have been lots and lots of demands from the industry, from the corporate honchos, financial institutions, etc. But all said and done, while the needs are unlimited, the means to achieve those needs are very limited, because we need to be very judicious in terms of planning our expenditure in line with our revenues, while at the same time lives and livelihoods need to be taken care of. Now let's go back to 2 or 3 weeks before, approximately April 15th. There were only few pockets which were affected because of the second wave of corona. We thought that lockdown in those areas will help us contain the virus at an all India level. But the situation today, it's completely different. What was once a local issue has now spread throughout the length and breadth of the country. And of course, it's a sign of relief that the manufacturing operations are on. But at the same time, the speed at which the second wave has hit us is a cause of concern for every citizen of our country. So now is time that we need to introduce more liquidity into the system, and we need to look in terms of, once again, if there is a need to bring those moratoriums and other measures. Many banks are open for that. There's nothing wrong, this interest on interest, etc. Those issues will keep happening. But at the same time, at the grassroots levels, things have to be deterred by this and fall back. We need to keep fighting and we need to keep moving on. That's very important. Now, if you look at the moratorium, they were all restricted only to the MSMEs and the individual borrowers, etc., etc., especially to them. But normally, during these times of crisis, the formal sector of the industry, they always have an advantage. Big companies are not affected. It's only the small businesses, the small businesses, they are affected because they don't have the financial muscle. Now, each one of us were thinking that the pandemic was drawing to a close. We were under the false impression. Of course, it turned out to be false later, that we were almost under the impression that everything is over and we were on the foothills of positive recovery. And we were seeing that the curve was, you know, almost being flattened. While the whole world was grappling with this crisis, we had a feeling that we have already come out. Nothing wrong in being optimistic, but in a few weeks, the situation completely changed. We are now fighting new mutants of this virus, some African, some Brazilian, some German, I don't know, host of new. Today they were talking about some South Indian variant. Okay, things are unfolding slowly and steadily. And shortage of oxygen, shortage of transport, the hospital infrastructure falling short, and the whole story is unfolding. But at the same time, we as responsible citizens, we shouldn't be deterred by all these things. It is important that each one of us mount a valiant defense to ramp up the medical infrastructure, hospital infrastructure, etc., etc. The government, obviously, we can see that it's trying its level best. A lot of things the government is doing, not just the central, even the state government, irrespective of any party affiliations, all state governments are doing their best to bring back normalcy in the workplace. We always talk of government employees. Now look at the government employees in the administration, the IAS officer, the complete bureaucracy. They're all working around the clock only to ensure that the normalcy is restored. We're not talking of political affiliations now. Whichever party is in rule in the state government, every state government is fighting this virus net to net. But at the same time, as public, we also have a responsibility in terms of how we can support the government in combating this menace. Now, as far as RBI is concerned, we're going to look at some of the steps the RBI has taken to fight the situation. You know, the individuals, the businesses, the institution, everybody is fighting this war. And we need to see from an economic perspective, from a macroeconomic perspective, what the government is doing and how we can cooperate in this whole economic revival. In the words of the Reserve Bank governor, he clearly talks about calibrated, sequenced and well-timed actions in order to reach out to everyone. Beautiful words he said, calibrated, sequenced and well timed. Very, very important message by the RBI governor. He also says that it's important for us to reach out to each and everyone, especially the ones who are most vulnerable. Now, if you look at the administration, we have already talked about it. We have braved this tactic. Our doctors, police, law enforcing agencies, all these people, all authorities who have battled the second wave, especially the frontline people, the whole nation is indebted to them much more than ever. Now, if you look at some of the RBI, steps of the RBI that they have taken, in fact, the facilities within their own RBI, their own staff who were involved in these policy decisions, they were working round the clock in order to ensure that there is continuity of financial markets. And we have seen that happening even when the COVID was at its peak during the last year. So many efforts were taken in terms of introduction of PLI scheme for manufacturing industries, in terms of moratoriums for individuals, loans for SMEs, loan restructuring. All those things were done approximately 7 or 8 months back. Today, the stock market is going to new heights. We are far much in a better place. It is not something that happened by accident. There is a meticulous planning that has gone behind this, which is evident from the last 3 or 4 months. Look at GST collections, look at your current account surpluses, look at your balance of trade, look at your exports, right? Continuously, we are breaking all records of past months, at least in the last 4 or 5 months. Your Atmanirbhar campaign, everything is going on perfectly fine. They're all going unabated in spite of this pandemic. Of course, because of proactive measures. Of course, no one can make a 100% perfect policy, because policies are made in a climate of uncertainty. We don't know what the future is. But looking at the current situation, I think the government has been extremely proactive in terms of instituting the right policies just to ensure that the economy chugs along quite well. Now, if you look at the history from last September to February, we have managed to reduce the infection to a great extent, especially when the rest of the world were suffering. But we need to continue to marshal our resources, and we cannot afford to be complacent. So, before the government take any actions, we are talking about the RBI, it is important that the more overall macroeconomic and financial conditions need to be kept in mind. We need to understand the context in which the government is taking all these measures. Now what is happening is the global economy has started signs of recovery supported by monetary and fiscal stimulus. US government is pumping trillions of dollars into the system just to ensure that the country comes out of the crisis. You know, $1 trillion being pumped in, you can imagine the extent of accelerator and multiplier effects that it can bring to the economy. So when we're talking about the economy, it's not just the US economy, but it's domino effect throughout the world. So we are giving different, you know, different colors. One side we are talking about the positive outlook. Other side we are talking about negative outlook, talking of shortage of oxygen in hospital infrastructure. We can't be complacent, okay? We just can't keep looking at the positive things alone. We have to look at the negative things and we need to keep ourselves prepared, okay? A lot of issues are there. So as public, we also have irresponsibility and we cannot afford to be complacency, and we have our own rights and duties. We have our own duties, something that we studied in school, right? So now some of the positive things like the global growth projections, they are far more better than how we were 6 months back. Look at the share market, the financial markets. In fact, the International Monetary Fund had revised the global projection to 6% from approximately 3.5 or 4%, 3 or 4 months back. The climate is very positive, optimistic. Okay, everyone expects that we will be completely out of this crisis by the first half of the year, especially as far as the advanced countries are concerned, and the emerging economies. People hope that everyone will be out of this crisis by the summer of 2021. Right now let's look at some of the positive things. The world's merchandise trade is increasing, the CPI inflation largely is under control, the financial markets are gaining quite a good buoyancy, the aggregate supplies are slightly underpinned because of supply chain constraints, but at the same time we have record production of food grains. So as far as the food security is concerned, we are all poised for a very good monsoon during this year, and they are all doing extremely well. In fact, the meteorological department has already forecasted a very good monsoon during this year. So we can expect bumper results, excellent earnings from corporate companies when each of these corporates starts announcing their results for the first quarter of this year. But at the same time, we are also seeing the contact intensive services like your gyms, your spas, your hotels, they are all seeing a dip, but we can hope that in the coming months they will all improve. Of course, restrictions of containments are localized and people are learning to adapt to the new nature of this pandemic. Small businesses, MSMEs, traders, transporters, they've all learned to survive and do business in this kind of environment of restrictions and physical movements. We all can understand when there are restrictions on physical movement, how much it affects the business and the overall sentiments. Okay. On the other side, the average production of electricity has increased, the sale of consumer goods have increased, the rail freight has generated good amount of growth. As regards the toll tax, etc., of course, they have slightly declined. That's because of restrictions on transportations, etc. The tractor continues its march, doing extremely well. The PMI index, the Purchase Managers Index, which is one of the important indicators of economic health, that is improving. It is in the expansion mode continuously for the last 6 or 7 months. And the results for the month of May is not out, but we can hope for a slight dip, but we will come back to normalcy as soon as possible. Okay, so as far as the food inflation has largely remained constant, the price of petrol, diesel has slightly come down, there have been slight reduction in the prices of late. So these things are, you know, have given a shot in the arm, a fillip to the overall economy, and there are enough reasons for us to be optimistic. Now, the government has put in certain measures in terms of macroeconomics. Very, very important measures have been put in place by the government, but they're all very macroeconomic. They're all academic in nature, so I wouldn't like to include those topics here, but I will be making a separate video on that. Those of you who would like to understand the rudiments of macroeconomics and what each one of that has to do with economic growth, I encourage you to watch the next video. If you are preparing for IAS exams, do watch that, because we are going to talk about macroeconomics. We will talk about some important things, something like we will first learn about certain terms in macroeconomics. because not everyone who is watching this video may have studied economics. They may not understand certain basic definitions of economics. So I will start with an introduction to macroeconomics and then try to connect those academic principles, academic concepts to what is being announced by the Reserve Bank governor. Obviously, you're not going to write an examination in economics, but as corporate executives, part of the society, you interact with a lot of people, you go to parks, you visit your clubs, you discuss with your friends. If you're a corporate honcho, you may be giving presentations to your board of directors, where knowledge of these elements will help you a lot in terms of putting up your presentations in a much better manner. While at the same time, as an educated and responsible citizen of this country, you will be able to talk in terms of what the government is doing, appreciate what the government is doing. You will be able to understand economics, you will be able to critique what is good or not, and from your own experience, you will be in a position to suggest certain things to the government. The government is open. Modi sir is very open to listen to your suggestions and bring in initiatives. So in that video, we will be talking about what is reverse repo rate, what is repo rate, what is G-Sec, how does the government get into open market operations, how do banks use various instruments of credit control. Typically, when you talk about instrument of credit control, you have interest rates, you manage interest rates, how interest rates play a role in controlling your inflation, CPI, is inflation good or not, too high, too low, what is stagflation, how does it impact people at low levels, how does it impact demand and supply, what is commodity prices, what is a steel cycle, super cycle, what is its impact on. These are some of the things that I would be discussing in the next video, which will be completely about macroeconomics. And if you are interested, you can watch that video also, and that video will be full of macroeconomic figures. We will be talking about how much about the government G-Sec auctions, what happened, this 50,000 crores, where is it going to come from, what is this auction, how does money flow into the system. We will be discussing a whole lot of things like this. In fact, I will also be taking up one small important news item from the newspaper every day, and along with that, I will be teaching academics in terms of what it is, what it means to all of us as public citizens, what it means to the industry and all that. Okay, so that's some initiative that will keep continuing, right? Okay guys, wait for my next video. Thank you very much. Do put in your comments here, because I'm so willing to listen to your comments in terms of what is good, what is not. If you have opposing views, please put that in the comment section. I would like to go through each of them, and I promise I will come back to you, get back to you if you have opposing views. Okay, thank you very much. So nice being with you, interacting with you. Thank you very much. And this is Dr. Sadashivam signing off till we meet again. Thank you. Jai Hind. Take care.